no name higher than yours, no other word or gospel by which we are saved, Lord Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice. Good morning, family. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Isaiah 53 says, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. But surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What amazing power and grace, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus, for breaking the power of sin and darkness over us, Lord God. We celebrate that this morning. We celebrate, oh God, your mighty love. We celebrate, oh God, your wonder in our lives. Hallelujah. This is amazing grace. Worship with us this morning. Put your hands together.
Take my place, that you would bear my place. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hallelujah. Open your mouth and give God thanks. It will encourage somebody this morning. It encourages me this morning to hear you celebrating. Hallelujah.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Coming, oh God, our firm foundation, the rock of our lives, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for giving it all and paying the price that we would have, oh God, your promised Holy Spirit, and that we are able to walk in this life in obedience as you did. Your power, God, is our power, Lord. With us.
The rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaken. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So I would he fail now? He won't.
When we are unfaithful, you are faithful. When we forsake you, you never leave and forsake, oh God. From generation to generation to generation to generation, you are God. And we worship you this morning, Lord. We worship you, God, with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our mind, with all our strength, Lord. You are the Lord, no matter what. Thank you.
Jesus Christ, my King.
for the power, O God, of the gospel in our lives. The gospel unto salvation, God. The gospel, O God, that is our strength, that is our power, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for us, Lord God.
Just lift your hands this morning. Let's worship the risen King. Our God reigns. We bless you, Jesus. We look to you, Jesus. We look to the beautiful name of Jesus. For we can run to you and find safety. Why don't you just, with your hands lifted this morning, just take 30 seconds. If you're at your home and you're watching online, there's nothing like worshiping God for who He is. For every name is a representation of the attributes, the character of God. And they're all founded in this truth that God is love, no matter what. So come on, just lift your hands above your heads and begin to give Him thanks for the life that you have. Begin to give Him thanks for the health that you have. Begin to give Him thanks for the hope that you have. Begin to give Him thanks for the salvation you have received. Begin to give Him thanks for the mercy He has shown. Begin to give Him thanks for the grace He has poured out. Begin to give Him thanks for cleansing us of all sin. Hallelujah. Come on, just open your mouths, young and old. He's worthy to be praised. We can call on the name of Jesus, for at the sound of His name, every knee bows down and every tongue confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I love that hope is found in Jesus, and as we worship Him, you know, we may have come with emotional burdens. We may have come with cares because of life circumstances. His word says, cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. He asks us to leave our heavy burden with Him and take His burden that is light. Says His yoke is easy. Says there's a place in Him where we can find rest for our souls. Says, come unto me, all you who are burdened and heavy laden by life circumstances. He gives us permission to come to Him. And that is an individual call. While we may do it in a corporate setting where we pray for one another, there's nothing more powerful than a child of God speaking to God, their Father. And there's this little story about a man who was sitting outside of the White House. And he wanted to see the president, but he couldn't have access. And then a little boy saw him and ask him what his concerns were. And he told him that, I want to have conversation with the president. And so the little boy held him by his hand and they started walking. They passed the security. They passed all the gates and they went through all the doors and they went into the father's office. Then when the little boy got in there, he said, Dad, this veteran would like to speak with you. The moral of the story is that not even the security stopped the son. So the man had access because the son brought him to his Father's office. So this morning we have access to God the Father through Jesus the Son. And every one of us who stand on the outside of that gate, the Son is here this morning to hold us by the hand and bring us in. So just take a minute. Whatever burden you have, whatever care you have, just lay that on Jesus this morning. You open your mouth and you pray to him for your breakthrough. You pray to him for your deliverance. You pray to him concerning your family, concerning sickness. Lay it all on him this morning. So Heavenly Father, we come to you in the mighty, matchless, powerful, beautiful name of Jesus. God, we cast our cares upon you. We're hurting emotionally. Some are struggling financially. Some are wavering spiritually. And so, Lord, we say this morning that we need your intervention. We need your involvement. We need your participation in our lives' transformation. So we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask you to do a new work in us, to change us from the inside out, to take the cares, to take the heavy burden, to take the difficult yoke that we often bear. We ask you in the name of Jesus to heal where we are sick in body in the name of Jesus. Heal back pains and abdominal pains and head pains, and remove fevers and coughs in the name of Jesus. Lord, heal things concerning our internal organs, the kidney, lungs, whatever it is, the heart, whatever it is, Lord, do a work this morning. Renew physical strength and spiritual strength to your sons and your daughters this morning. Lord God Almighty, there are many of us who are at a crossroads. We don't know where to go. We don't know what to do. We look to you in the name of Jesus, and we ask you for clarity of vision. We ask you for direction in the name of Jesus. We ask you to make a way where there is no way in the name of Jesus. We ask you, Lord God Almighty, to lead, and we will follow in the name of Jesus. Lord, there are others who are going through warfare spiritually, warfare maritally, warfare financially, warfare at the workplace. Remind us, Lord God, that the weapons of our warfare as children of God, they are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. And we have been given an armor so that we can stand against the wiles of the devil in the evil day. Let us be reminded that no weapon that is formed against us can prosper in the name of Jesus. For you are with us, and the angels of the Lord encamped round about us. Lord God, we pray for protection over everything concerning us. Lord God Almighty, we pray for protection of home and another property, protection around sons and daughters, grandchildren, protection around our spouses, protection around our business interests as we serve and honor you, Almighty God. Resurrected King, we pray that you would come and resurrect those who are dead spiritually in the name of Jesus. We declare, as the song says, Lord God, by your spirit we will rise from the ashes of defeat. Come on, just lift your hands and declare that by his spirit, it's not by might, it's not by power. Come on, just declare that. Whatever you're going to, by your spirit, I will rise. By your spirit, Lord, we will rise. By your spirit, we will rise. It may be difficult now, but by his spirit. You may be in a tough spot right now, but by his spirit. I don't know what you're going through, but this is for you. By his spirit, you will rise. because he rose from the dead. This morning is the first Sunday, and we have a time of communion in fellowship. And it's awesome as I reflected this week on the death, the burial, and resurrection of Jesus, that in our culture, it is normal that when people are about to die, that those who are well take care of them. We care for them because we say they are on their dying beds, they're about to die for whatever reason. Here it is that Jesus Christ is about to give up his life, and he loved so much that he cared for his disciples. He washed their feet and he fed them. Oh, what a savior. That when he should be cared for, he was caring. That's how much God loves you and how much God cares for you this morning. That even if it cost him his life again and again and again, if it were possible for him to go to the cross again and again, and if it were necessary, he would do it for you. That's how much he cares for you. And so when we come to this time of communion, we reflect on the great love of God, the magnitude of his love. We're going to invite the ushers to come forward. They're going to stand in the aisles so you can, you know, just grab the juice that this morning speaks to his blood, and the wafers that we have that speaks to his body. And if you're at home, maybe you're not able to be with us in the sanctuary this morning. You may not have the same things that we have, but what is more important is the significance of what is done. And so you may have your own bread at home. You break that, and you may have some other form of grape juice. You go ahead and let us consecrate these things unto the Lord. And let us, as the people of God, because communion is for those who have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The Lord's prepared table is for his prepared people. It's not for everyone. It's for every believer, however. And you may be thinking, but I'm not walking like a believer. That's easily fixed. If you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you. And while sin may separate you from God relationally, it doesn't separate you from God in terms of your salvation. But if you belong to him, you belong to him. So all of us are instructed by the scriptures to search our hearts. So just right now, just take a couple of minutes and begin to pray and ask him, you know, if there's besetting sin, intentional sin, whatever it is, just the Lord forgive me. Oh God, forgive me and cleanse me. Wash me afresh. Purge me in the name of Jesus. I admit that as a man, as a human, we are frail and fragile. And it is impossible for us to live the life of holiness without the empowerment of your Holy Spirit. But very often we choose to do it by ourselves, and we find ourselves committing sin and walking outside of your will and your way. And so we come back to total reliance and dependence on the Spirit of the living God this morning. And we say, Lord, forgive us and have mercy. We thank you for the juice that represents and speaks to your blood, the wafer that speaks to your body. Lord, consecrate them this morning. And may, as we participate in this time of communal fellowship, that, Lord God, your Spirit would indeed rise within us. And that by the Spirit we will rise from every place of defeat and live the victorious life that you have called us into. In Jesus' name, amen. So the ushers are going to come. Just remain standing with us.
From the ashes of defeat, the resurrected King. your spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me.
Hallelujah. In your name we come alive to declare the victory. And that night he took the bread and he broke it. He blessed it. He gave thanks. He said, "This is my body that's broken for you." He gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Eat in remembrance of me." We thank you, Lord. We give thanks that you lay down your life to pick up ours. And there is no greater love than for a man to lay down his life for his brother. So we thank you, and we eat together as sons and daughters of the Most High God. In Jesus' name, amen. And in like manner he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood that has been poured out for you." The blood of Jesus is perpetual, and that is why he doesn't have to die again and again. Once and for all, and Calvary's cross. Realize how powerful this is. That more than 2,000 years and the blood still has power to save, to deliver, to heal, to protect. Oh, the blood still has power. Just declare with me that I am covered under the blood of Jesus. I'm protected by the blood of Jesus. I'm saved by the blood of Jesus. So we drink together in Jesus' name. We say, Lord God, one thing we desire in this moment is that we may dwell in the house of our God forever. Not a physical building, but in the sweetness of your presence. May we forever abide. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. And amen. Come on, just put your hands together this morning. Give the Lord a big hand clap. Come on, he deserves something better than that. Hallelujah. He's great, he's mighty, he's awesome, and he is a good God. He is the blessed God forever and ever and ever. And there is power in his name. Amen. There is no other name given by which men can be saved except the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. It's good to see you this morning. It's good to be with you. I just want to do a couple of things before we get into our announcements. I mean, if there's anyone here for the first time, listen, we want to warmly welcome you as you worship with us at Church on the Rock. If you're online, though we will not be able to see you, but you can indicate on the online platform that this is your first time watching one of our services, and someone will respond to you. But if you're here in the building and this is your first time, we'd love for you to stand so we can recognize you and give you a warm Church on the Rock welcome. Anyone, this is your first time here. All right, don't look like there's any more pressure. Come on, just put your hands together for yourself this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, just want to say happy birthday and happy anniversary to all the persons celebrating their birthdays and anniversary in this month. We have a few other things that we want to get through quickly, which is one, Bible study continues this Wednesday at 6:30 with Minister Garfield Robinson as we continue our teachings on apologetics. We're also, because remember, cell group is going to begin in May, and so the books are here. You can start getting your books for cell groups. You can also sign up. We have an online form that you can get and sign up for our small group. It's part of our discipleship process. We're going to do a book called Growing Strong in God's Family, where all of us can grow together. And so the books are available, the form is available, and you can also speak to one of our ushers at the end of the service, and they will help you with signing up, or you can also indicate on the connection card that you have. All right, we have water baptism that is coming up on the 21st, and how we are going to do it. If you're not baptized, trust me, it's going to be so good that you're going to want to get baptized. All right, it's going to be a really great time because we want to do it after our second service, and we want to provide vehicles to bring the people to where the baptism is. So when we go there, the entire church will be there, so we can sing some of those good old baptism songs from time past. Amen. Meet me by the river and all of that. You know what I'm talking about. So that is the 21st. So if you're saved, huh? Not meet me by the river. No, that's not that one. Oh, that's a funeral song. I see. There you go. Okay, not meet me by the river. The water has troubled my friend. Okay, there you go. I know it's a water song. Hallelujah. Amen. But that is the 21st of April. So come out and get baptized and fulfill all righteousness according to the scriptures. All right. Do you need someone to pray with you? Call the church prayer line at 876-332-2770. Mondays to Saturdays from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. Just one quick thing I want you all to know. There's a car that needs to, your windows are down, so you need to check your car. The thing is here. But also, well, let me help you with one thing, all right? So if you normally are on the internet on a Sunday, you'll realize that you're not on it because we had to change it, because people are very smart, right? So because it's a QR code based thing, so once one person has it, they can spread it to everyone. So what was happening is that many persons missed some of the stuff on online last week Sunday because the internet got unstable because of the high usage. All right? So what we had to do is to change the password. All right? So don't blame anyone. We had to do that. But we are going to fix it. We are going to get a separate internet that if you have to use the internet, you can have it and use it. That's the guest internet, because we have to ensure that those who are online can participate in the service. Amen? So just give us a couple of weeks and you'll have internet so you can roam and do all that stuff. But we had to do that just so that we can provide good quality to those watching online. Amen? Amen. All right, so we're going to give to the Lord, and then we're going to get into the word of the Lord. As usual, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. We have a couple of ways. Well, a few ways that you can give. One, you can give using the QR code, which takes you straight to the website. You can give using an envelope. If you're here and you want to do that, you can. Or you can also, if for whatever reason you can't use the QR code and you feel like do transfer, there's a way for you to do that. All right? So those are three ways that you can give. All right? So I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to give our offerings or tithes to the Lord. We're gonna be a blessing to the kingdom of God as we continue to be a blessing to each other. Again, I want to encourage you that always seek an opportunity to be a blessing to people. Because God bless us so that we can be a blessing to others. And we must always seek for that opportunity. How can I be a blessing to someone today? It may not be something that is considered significant, but it may have a significant impact because kindness is shown. Amen. So we're going to lift our gifts. We're going to give to the Lord. And listen, if you do it with the right attitude and you're giving God the best that you can in the moment that you are, then God appreciates that and he celebrates that, because he'd prefer for us not to give if we don't want to give, or if we're going to dishonor him in what we give. Amen? So if we're giving, make sure that we are giving him our best, and make sure that what we are doing, listen, we are delighted that we have the opportunity to do it. Amen? So let's go after three. 1, 2, 3. Father, we declare that because we are 100% tithers and offering givers, you will open up the windows of heaven, favorable opportunities, and increase for us. We declare that we are blessed to be a blessing to the kingdom of God, our families, church, and community. You are raising up someone somewhere to use their ability, power, and influence to help us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may come forward and give your gifts. There's something that I'm forgetting to share, but let me say, listen, all right, big, big thank you for everyone who served over the last month to help us as a church and as a family of God to experience God's miraculous power. Amen. And I think we need to give God glory by clapping our hands for it. For the work that God did as we avail ourselves to him. But here's what I have to do this right, because 30 seconds. It's not a moment, it's a movement. So God is doing something. So what we need to ensure is that we don't go back to what we used to be, because it was just about one Sunday, but that we continue to ride the wave of what God is doing in the now. Amen. So maybe you volunteered because it was that Sunday you feel like, I am not going to do this again. No, it's a move. And stay engaged in the move of God. It's not a moment, it's a movement. And so make sure you live in the movement. Amen. And continue to serve, continue to share the gospel, continue to trust God for big dreams and big vision, and continue to be obedient to him and see him do great and mighty things in our midst. Amen. Hallelujah. This morning, we want to pick up by doing a new series, and really because people go through a lot in life, and people need a place to belong. A place where they feel like they are loved and accepted for who they are and how they are, and people love them enough to help to work with them in becoming who God has purposed them to be. People all over need a place to belong. The desire of most people, it comes down to even natural things. People want to have their own homes and own stuff. There's a sense of belonging that's in the heart of people and in the minds of people. When it comes down to relationship, it's the same thing. People want their own marriages. They want their own kids. Yeah, they enjoy your own and they love talking about your marriage, but they want to talk about their marriage because people love to feel like this is me. This I'm a part of this. People all over want a sense of belonging because people go through a lot in life. I mean, if you just check our childhood, maybe you didn't have a rough life, but even the people who have what we'd consider some of the easiest lives have stuff that they go through emotionally, even in their family setting, that causes them to crave for something more. And so as a church, as the people of God, the ecclesia, the called out ones, we are in the world to help people to know that you belong. You belong here. You belong not just to this church group, but you belong to the kingdom of God. You are a part of us. And so we're going to be going through that for a couple of weeks just to help people to navigate some of the tough emotional things that they go through, and just help them to understand that we love you and we want you to be a part of this. Amen? Isn't that a good thing to imagine if we started, so listen, I love you and I want you to be a part of this. What is this? A part of what we are enjoying in the kingdom of God. And so why do people belong? Because people want a place to be loved. And we need to be a place where people are loved for who they are, regardless of how they are. Because I don't love how you do things. I don't love how you are. But I love who you are. Because who you are is really who you are. How you are can change. Amen? Our key text is taken from Matthew chapter 22, from verse 34 to 40. That's where we'll be reading from. Not long, but a very powerful passage of scripture. Matthew chapter 22. I'm going to ask you to find that in your Bibles. We're going to stand for the 22 from 34 to 40. I'm going to ask you to stand with me for the reading of the Word of God, and then we're going to pray, and then we're going to have an exciting time as we dive into God's Word and be led by the Holy Spirit. So come on, just stand to your feet with me just for a moment and just lift your Bibles up. Hallelujah. As I want you to know that this month we will be, as a church, reading through the book of John. So make sure you get connected. You should have started already, but if not, it's not too late. Hallelujah. Better never late, though. Amen. Come on, just lift your Bibles up and declare with me that this is God's word, not Pastor Omar's word. I am what it says I am. I can do what it says I can do. I can be what it says I can be. And I will have what it says I can have. Today, I will hear the word of God. I boldly declare that my mind is alert. My heart is receptive. My ears are opened. And I better not go to sleep. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Remain standing with me. Verse 34. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees with his reply, they met together to question him again. One of them, an expert in religious law, tried to trap him with this question. Teacher, which is the most important commandment in the law of Moses? Verse 37, reading from the New Living Translation, chapter 22. Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is what? Equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning. Thank you that indeed it is living and powerful and sharper than a two-edged sword. Spirit of the living God, have your way this morning. Open eyes to see your truth, ears to hear your voice, minds to understand your word, and hearts to receive what you have in store for us. May we never be the same in Jesus' name. Do a mighty work. Let nothing distract us from what you're about to do. Because our freedom, Lord God, our deliverance, our answer, Our solution is in your presence this morning by the power of your word. We give you glory and honor and praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Thank you so much. You may be seated. So if loving God according to the text is our greatest purpose, then our second priority is loving people. Jesus says here that these two commandments are connected. And when he says the second command is like the first, that means similar to it, or it is connected to it. So part of loving God involves loving people. Part of loving God involves loving people. Just imagine if someone came up to you or came up to me and said, you know, I really, really like you, Pastor Omar, but I can't stand your wife. Do you think I'd want to be friends with that person? Because part of liking me is liking my wife, because we are a package deal. Amen? And so it is similar that it's a package deal when it comes down to God and God's family. You can't love God's family and not love God, and you can't love God and not love God's family. In fact, 1 John 4 verse 20 says it this way. If any man says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he's a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot. Look at that word. Cannot love God. Not will not, cannot love God. Mean it is impossible to not love your brother and love God. Impossible. No matter how we put style on it, no matter how we try to use eloquent words to phrase it, it is impossible. Cannot love God whom he has not seen. Verse 21 says, and he has given us this command, whoever loves God must also love his brother. So turn to the person beside you and say, you have no choice but to love me. That was easy because you're beside your friend, right? Maybe. So turn to the other person that you don't know and say to them, you have no choice but to love me. You know what I love about that? There are no conditions in it. It doesn't say if they behave well, if they are perfect, if they act nice, if they do this. The reason for it is because they are brother. Meaning because you're part of the family, you have to love them. Because God knows that people need love. So our second priority and purpose individually and as a church is learning to love God's family. It won't be easy, but we must learn. We will be with our spiritual family forever. You see, our physical family may fall apart, but our spiritual family will last forever because God wants us to learn to love one another. And in fact, the word for loving God's family is the word fellowship. But many people believe that fellowship means casual conversation. It means eating out together or hanging around church to talk about sports, to talk about politics or about weather, or to talk about clothes and hairstyle for females. But fellowship simply means loving God's family. Fellowship is not hanging out, though hanging out can be a part of fellowship. Fellowship goes deeper than hanging out with people, because you can hang out with people but have no fellowship with people. So how do we learn to love God's family? What does fellowship really mean? And how all of this connects? So there are four different levels of fellowship, and I believe that as children of God, we have to manifest that in the church of God. This is if we want to see the lost coming and the lost loving God and serving God, then there are some things that we're going to have to adjust in terms of how we operate and how we behave, because we have many stereotypes in how we share love. We love when we want, who we want, and we challenge people to be what we want them to be so we can love them how we want to love them. God says, no, it is love that covers. Don't ask people to cover stuff and then you love them. He says love them because love covers. Right? Love covers a multitude of sin. We normally want people to cover everything in their life, meaning get it right, and then we say, okay, now that you have covered this stuff, now that you have dealt with it, now that you're behaving yourself, now that you're acting godly, now that you're very Christianized, now that you're praying enough, now that you're involved more in church, I can really show you what true love is. God says, no, no, when you love them up front, what happens, it helps to cover all the stuff that you'd want them to change, because that's how good and powerful God is. So the first level of fellowship is what we call membership. Very easy. It is choosing to belong. So the first and most basic level of fellowship is membership. This means making the choice to belong. All right? And this is important. So people need to make a choice to belong. All right? Do you know that all of us belong to someone? Amen? If you're... You either belong to your husband, or you belong to your wife, or you belong to your mother, or you belong to your father. But everybody belongs to somebody. Because people need belonging. Do you also know that place was made before people? So therefore, everyone belongs to a place. That means that every person in this room, there's a place for you to belong. But we have to make the choice to belong. So that means you find a church family and you choose to get connected to it. You have to get connected to a family. Get connected. We have to be connected. We have to be connected. Do you know a good example? If you do, if you did like agriculture or some level of biology in school, you know about gravitropism, right? And phototropism, right? Amen. Anybody? So phototropism is when the sunlight is trapped by the plant to grow, but gravitropism is gravity. That is trapped, so the root system can grow. So everything that happens in the roots, everything that you see above the ground with a plant, right, it happens in the root system beneath the earth. So both is important, right? So the plant is spreading out underground, but it's spreading out above the ground. But both are connected. You can't have phototropism without gravitropism. And you can't have gravitropism and not have phototropism. In other words, you can only grow if you get planted. There's nothing that grows without being connected. We have to make that choice. How the Bible says it? Ephesians 2 verse 19. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. Built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. So the Christian life is not just a matter of believing. While believing is important, it is a matter of belonging. And belonging is a choice that you make and that I make. We have to make the choice to belong. So turn to your neighbor and say to them, you have to choose to belong. That means get connected. If you want to grow and become all that God has called you to be, there's a place for you to belong, but you must get connected. Because fellowship begins with belonging, with making a choice to be in fellowship, making a choice to be connected. God wants you to identify, to make the choice to be a part of his family. Because the church is a place where we live out what it means to be a Christian. See, a Christian without a church family is an orphan. God wants us all to be a part and part of and connected to his family. The reason why you're here is because God wants you to be a part of his family. And he knows, God knows that you need family. You need friendship. You need people. People need people. Romans 12 verse 5. So in Christ, we who are many form one body. And each member belongs to all the others. We belong to all the others. In other words, I belong to you. And you belong to me. What a joy that is. Oh, Lord, I know sometimes we don't like each other. But listen, you belong to me. Get used to it. Get used to it. Right. Because Jesus understood that the disciples belonged to him and he belonged to them. Know what? Though they had many flaws and imperfection, including Judas, including Peter, including James and John, they all had their issues, but they all belong. Because belonging doesn't mean perfection. It means working on life together. So the word membership comes from the Bible actually, but today has a different meaning. For some, it means being a part of some club or organization by signing up for this or joining that. But membership isn't about being a part of some club. Being a member means that you are joined tightly as a part of a larger body. It is about belonging to each other, making the choice to belong to a family. See, there are many floating believers in the world today. These are people who go from church to church. 1 week they like to speak at that church, so they go there. The next week, something different. If you want to grow, you have to get joined to a body. I know there is transplanting, right? But if every day you transplant the plant going to die. Amen? I think there's in transplanting after two times, three strikes, you know how it goes here. Yeah, right? Two times is good. Three strikes. So if you want to grow, you have to join a body. And I'm not saying that you can't go, or you can never go and visit a different church. No, I'm saying that you have to choose a home church, a place you are committed to, a people that you're going to join and partner with in doing God's work. Can you imagine a member of your body jumping from place to place? If your liver decided that one day you just wanted to detach and jump into another body, and then next week you see it coming back over to you. Just imagine that. Just imagine your liver leave you and say, listen, I need to go check out. Because I don't like your body. So you go check out a body down the road. And in 3 or 4 weeks' time, you see liver coming back and say, listen, me no like this, so me really want to come. What did you do? But not only that, it probably shrivel up and die, right? And the same thing happens to us as believers. We need to attach ourselves to a group of believers where we say, I want to be a part of what's going on here. And that's what people need to see when they come to church. They need to see a people joined tightly together that they can say, listen, these people are not only believing. There's a sense of belonging. There's love in this room. I can feel it. I can sense it. And I want to be a part of what God is doing here. So how one becomes a member? One way is through baptism. And baptism is really a public way of saying that you're part of a group of believers and you're excited to belong. That is why we encourage people to get water baptized. Romans 6 verse 3 have this beautiful picture of baptism. When we are lowered into the water, it is like the burial of Jesus. And when we are raised up out of the water, it is like the resurrection of Jesus. I think that's just an awesome picture, that while we don't go through death, burial, and resurrection in a physical sense, we can share that experience in the waters of baptism. Baptism is such a great and awesome thing because it is the only thing in the Christian church that really allows the believer in a spiritual sense to experience what Jesus Christ went through. Burial and resurrection. So baptism is a public way of saying that we have died to self and now live for Christ. And so if you have already been baptized, then becoming a member simply means making the commitment to choose. Maybe this is your church home or some other church home. But if you're not baptized, you need to get baptized. Maybe I've been coming here for years, but I've never made that commitment. Maybe you were burnt in the past by a church. Maybe you have had hard times now making that commitment again. Talk to someone, because listen, staying away from people don't solve our problem of hurt. And oftentimes the enemy tells us that, listen, the best thing to do when you're hurting is stay away from people. Listen, healing is in the meeting. Let me say it again. Healing is in the meeting. It is in the congregation and fellowship of people. You see, the family who sticks together in pain heal faster than the family that is divided in pain. Amen? So first level is membership. Second level is friendship. And the friendship level is where we're learning to share. Right? It means, oh, this is so good. Listen, we need friendship in the church. We are not just members, we are friends. The church ought to have not just membership, but the church supposed to have friendship. Amen? So if you don't have any friend, you need to. He who wins friend is friendly. That's in the Bible. If you want to win friends, you have to be friendly. And that is why when people come to church, you have to smile. Even if you have dentures, it's okay, smile. It don't matter. Or you have no dentures and stuff, smile. Because people need friendship. Because the friendship level is where we learn to share. So the second level of fellowship is a little deeper as you spend time and share with other people. Friendship develops. You were created. We were created in God's image, so we were made for relationship. Mankind, people are made for relationship. Even a person who's single, they want a relationship. Not like a boyfriend or a girlfriend or a husband or a wife. But everyone needs relationship. Amen? All of us need relationship. There's something inside of the young man, the young woman, the old woman who is coming to church for the first time. And one of the things that is inside of them yearning is, will I be able to share in relationship with these people? And so if the church doesn't learn to love people and it's not a place where people feel loved, then they won't have a sense of friendship and they won't want to be around us. That is why we wanted to greet people. Shake their hand. You understand me? Share with people. The Bible says it is not good for man to be alone. And that's just for everybody. In other words, that means more than just marriage. It's not just a marriage scripture. We were made for relationship with one another. Life is not a solo act. We all need friends. All right, come on. Tell your neighbor that you need friends. No, you need to ask them, do you have any friends? And if they say no, just say to them, no, really have a conversation. To ask them, do you have any friends? And if they say no, listen, we're going to work on that. It's not normal for a child of God to not have friends. It is abnormal. If you don't have any friends and you're a child of God, something is off with you. It may not be a lot of friends because some of us have too many friends. And then some have wrong friends. Acts 2, 44 to 46. This is friendship. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. That's friendship. The men and women of the time met together, although they said apostles, and run boat regularly. Friendship requires two essentials seen in verse 44. The first is that they were together, and the second is that they had everything in common. In order for deep friendship, you have to spend time together and you have to share with other people. We have to share with one another. Because sharing is? Yeah. I don't know where it comes from, but it makes a lot of sense. Sharing is caring. And people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. So, that's what I love with Jesus. If you look at the ministry of Jesus, oftentimes he would sit down with the people when they said the people were hungry and they said they had nothing to feed them and what it would cost to feed them. Then they found some fish and bread. Jesus multiplied it by the power of God so everyone could have it. He was concerned about the needs of the people because people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And that knowing and that caring happens in healthy friendship. Because friendship is a choice you make. Do you know why most people are lonely? They don't make time for friendships. They are too busy working or doing other things. They will tell you that. They will tell us, am I work? Am I friend? Some will say, am I money? Am I friend? They are not willing to put time into it. But Acts is saying that they met together. If we are going to be friends, we have to meet together. So until we start saying this is going to be a priority in my life, we are not going to develop any deep friends. And church and fellowship needs friendship. They don't just happen. They happen because you choose to make the time for them. Friendship is a choice. No, please understand. Everybody can't be a friend. But we, as believers, we must be friendly to everybody. All right? But not everybody going to be a friend. But we need friends. And you can't be a believer and not have friends. And it is not the friends who make the choice. You also must make a choice to belong, and you must make a choice to be friendly. So, here's what happened. In the family of God, we need to learn to share with other believers. We need to share with one another. But what do we share? The first thing is that we can share our experiences. We need to share our experiences. Do you know the Bible says that we can learn from one another, because it says, just as iron what? Sharpens iron. And what that is really teaching is that it is wise to learn from the experiences of other people, because you don't have time to make all the mistakes yourself. Let me help you. All of us, it is better to learn from other people's mistakes than you keep making them and learning. Other people's experience is a good teacher for us. That is why we need friendships, because when we are in friendships, and I can tell you about my experience, it gives you wisdom in making better decisions in your own personal life. Because I went through it, I can tell you about the pain of it, so you don't have to go through it. So if you learn everything in life by trial and error, you're going to go through a lot of problems unnecessarily. God says you can short circuit and learn a lot quicker if you learn from the experiences of other people. Nobody knows everything. We are all ignorant, just on different subjects. You know things I don't, and vice versa. We can learn from anybody if we just learn to ask the right question. So think of all the wealth of knowledge sitting here right now in this church family, in this service, and how much we could learn from each other if we just spend time together. Just look around you. If you were spending time to learn from some of the experiences of some of the people who are married, some of the people who have had death, some of the people who have had businesses, some of the people who have worked in different industries, if we spend time building relationships and friendships to the point where we are learning from each other's experience, many of our lives would be further ahead than they are today and avoided many mistakes. So we learn to share experiences. We also learn to share our homes. Right? I know this one is very difficult because for many people, their home is not a sanctuary. It is their sanctuary. All right? So, and then there are some people who don't believe that their home is the kind of home that them, the kind of people, want to come to. But I love in the book of Acts, the scripture said they moved from house to house. And it never told her that it was a 3-bedroom, 2-bedroom, 1-bedroom, board house, concrete house, tent house, cardboard house. It said from house to house. So if you want to come to my house, me want to come to your house. All of a 1-bedroom, you know. So why only big house we can go to? A nice house. Why we can only fellowship in our nice house? No, I'm trying to figure out, because the idea of the church is, you know what? Which are the nicest house for us to go to? Not move from house to house, you know. Let's find the nice homes and go to those homes. It says in 1 Peter 4, verse 9, it teaches that we are to open our homes to each other and to practice hospitality. Let me say it again. We are to open our homes to each other and practice hospitality. You cannot practice hospitality at my house. That happened at your house. So while you are giving me practice by coming to my house, I need to give you practice by going to your house. All right. How many people don't want nobody at their house? Put up your hand. Okay. All right. So some people don't want nobody at their house. I hope those people don't want to go to nobody. And if you have that, it's a problem, because it's not the practice of Scripture. It's real stuff. So, and it doesn't say just, the, like I said, the really nice ones. It just says open all of them up. So you can only fellowship in a small group, or you fellowship one-on-one. And the Sunday service is not the place of fellowship. People get upset about what happens on Sunday. Sunday is for meet and greet, not for fellowship. We can worship together. We can celebrate together. We can learn together. But fellowship takes place in smaller groups. And that is why we have small groups, because we understand that that's a more intimate place for people to be open and honest. Church on a Sunday is not the best place to have those intimate conversations. That is why we are going to take a lot of time and talk about small groups, and we have our cell groups coming up. The early church met in the temple courts, and they met from house to house. Come on, just say it with me, house to house. So say every house of every member. let me give you the other side to this. Because if we have a problem with how the house is, then here's the world of the church. Because everyone had everything in common, then we ought to ensure that that house is good enough to accommodate those who are going there. That's what the church did. So if the church was supposed to, in the time of Acts, if they were supposed to come to your house, and your house, the toilet wasn't flushing, the plumber among them would go over there and ensure that the toilet start flush. You understand me? If the house was not clean, a group of persons from the church, according to the culture, would go there and make sure the house is clean before the fellowship. If it needed painting, they would go over there and paint the house. Because if my house paint, your house will paint. Because we're supposed to have everything in. Come on. Imagine if church were like that. We share not only our experiences, not only our homes, but we share our problems. Yes. And here's why we share our problems, because we are not meant to face our problems alone. The Bible says, weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice. Sometimes in fellowship, you die of laughter and sometimes you're all shedding a tear. Why? It depends on what is going on in the lives of the people around you. But we share our problems. You don't mean we go around and tell everybody every detail about every part of every business that we have. But when we're going through stuff, we talk about it. Too often in the church, people go through stuff and nobody knows. And hold on. So your mother is dead. And you come to church. And you never say nothing to us. You do surgery. Oh, you didn't tell us to pray for you. Imagine with me that you're in your home and your son or your daughter goes out and does major surgery and never say anything to you as a parent. You see, that is the kind of bond that ought to be in the church. That when one of us hurt, we all hurt. And when one rejoice, we all rejoice. So you see, when you get promotion, we have celebration. Yes. And I'm sure we are show off, you know. But we celebrate family. It's just like sports day. You see, when my son win a race, I'm happy. And when I lose a race, I'm vexed. I'm unhappy. Yeah, that's me not vexed, unhappy. So it is in the church. I'll give you a quick example. When was it? I think it was on Thursday. You know, some people, you know, old people are saying you need to follow your spirit. Yeah, you know, as a Jamaican saying. So, a spirit tell me, said, do not leave your yard, you know. Not left your yard, you know. Call me, say, if you leave me yard. And you know that, I don't know. I have a car. I don't know why it like to touch the back of other people's car. Like, I'm telling you. The car, it just have this thing. And every time it touch the back of people's car, the people them car all right. And this one just like fall apart. Something is a special. It's a special type of car. So that happened. And I go to the police station trying to get everything sorted out and resolved. Over there, then Deslan is at the police station. Because what I run in the front of somebody's vehicle, somebody run in the back of his. Right? But here's a good thing. I think because God is so awesome, because both of us was there going through the same thing, it made the experience lighter. It's a joy of going through life together. I'm telling you. Because we're at the police station, so you know that man upset because the man who, I'm telling you, God is so good. So the man who I hit fussy but not upset. So Desmond to the man, I'm telling you, God is so good. I mean, man probably soon start to come to church. And I'm telling you, that is because both of us ended up in the station with similar issues. Because when life is done like that, when we share our problems and we go through them together, it makes it easier to handle. Amen? So there is membership, there is friendship, and then there is partnership. Doing my part, right? The third level of fellowship is partnership. Partnership means doing your part. It is realizing that you have a contribution to make and that the family of God needs you. You see, the truth is that God did not bring you to this church to sit back and soak up some spiritual spa. That's not why you're here. He brought you here to serve. And that is why last week was so important, because as people got involved, you saw the miraculous power of God working and moving and touching and changing lives. He wants to make a difference in people's lives through you and through me. In every family, there are family responsibilities. You divide up the chores. Everyone has a part. And so the family, the church is God's family, and every one of us has a part. But in order to be a part, you have to find your niche. You have to find out where you fit and begin to do what you fit into. Ephesians 4:16. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Come on, tell the person beside you, you need to do your work. Yes, yes, in the body of Christ, you need to do your work. The body is not going to function effectively if one organ is not functioning the way it ought to and not doing its work. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing together. Listen, you have a special responsibility that God has put upon you to make the church healthy and growing. And that is why God wants you to be connected, because there's something that God wants you to do in the house of God so that people's life can be changed and transformed. I know you are busy, but God has a work for you. I know you have a lot on your plate, but God has a work for you. I know that there's so much all around you, but that doesn't take away from the fact that God wants you to work in his kingdom, in his church, so that lives can change and the church can be healthy and the church can be growing. Each part, that means you. When we work together, we get things done. You have a part to play. When we cooperate, we get more done together than could ever get done by ourselves. What happens if each part doesn't do their part? Then the work does not get done. Because everybody said that it is somebody. Because somebody gets blamed. Because nobody wants to do it. You know, in the Arabic world, there's a word called Inshallah. E-N-S-H-A-L-A. And that means if God wills it. Often it is used to mean if it happens, it happens. In the church, we can sometimes have that kind of an attitude. You feel led to do something, but instead of moving forward, you sit back and think, well, if God wants this to happen, it will happen. He will raise up someone to get it done. Unfortunately, that is not a true statement. The Bible is full of cases where God wanted to see something happen, but the exact opposite of what God wanted to see happen occurred. Ezekiel 22 verse 30 says, I look for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land, so I would not have to destroy it. But I found none. In other words, God wanted someone to build a wall. No one was there to build the wall. So the land had to be destroyed because he found none. So many times the opposite of what God wants happens because people don't stand in the gap and do what ought to be done. The truth is that there are things that God wants to do that will not happen until we do it. If we don't do our part, it will not get done. Remember the story of Elisha and the widow. The amount of the oil was decided by the widow, not by God. God is sovereign, but he works through us. In other words, all of us have oil like the widow. The issue is, will you give your oil to God? Will you give your oil to God so that God can work through your oil to bring forth glory and do mighty miracles? Finally, kinship. So you have membership, partnership. Amen? We're coming now to kinship. Kinship is being a family. And the deepest level of fellowship in the family of God is called kinship. And this is an old term, and it isn't used much anymore. Kinship literally means your closest relationship. Kinship. Your closest family. In other words, when someone has an accident, they notify what they call the next of kin. That means you find the person closest to them. That is the kind of attitude we should have for one another. Kinship means treating and loving other believers like their family. You're completely committed to them. That's how we treat people. I learned something so important. I'm going to have this podcast that I listen to, right? I mean, something that I've known for a while, but it just reinforced something. He talked about filling the gap with trust. And where experience don't meet expectation, fill the gap with trust. Give people the benefit of the doubt. And in the teaching, he's talking about relationship. He says, when you're committed to people, right, even if you feel like something is wrong, here's what you do. Because you're committed to them, he says, this is Andy Stanley. He says that one of the greatest things to do is anytime you go to someone and says, listen, there is an issue, and I have not spoken to anyone about it. In other words, he teaches this. Part of building trust and showing complete commitment to people is always going to people and talking to them. Because sometimes, oftentimes when we have pain and we have hurt, you know what we do? If you're like me, most times we kind of say, okay, let me talk to this person, let me talk to that person before we actually talk to the person with the issue. And so he teaches that and he says, part of complete commitment is always be willing in family to talk to people. And he uses the example of a husband and a wife. And he says, whenever husband and wife have issue, the first place to have the conversation is between husband and wife. And he says, once you go outside of that, you have broken down trust in your marriage. And when it's broken, it's hard to restore. Amen? Right? So the Greek word for fellowship is the word koinonia. You know it very well, don't you? Right? Which comes from kinos, which means common or connected to. So tell the person beside you, you are connected to me. And I'm connected to you. That's what it means. We are connected. Most of us know John 3:16, right? God so? But do you know 1 John 3:16? This is how we know what love is. Jesus laid down his life for us. And we are to what? Lay down our lives for our brothers. John 15 verse 13. Greater love has no one than this. That he laid down his life for his friends. The Bible talks about the fellowship of suffering, and often we Christians don't really know about this level of fellowship, right? There are people struggling all over the world, and we need to understand that suffering together draw people closer in ways like nothing else. You can have fellowship in studying, sharing, and serving, but the deepest is the fellowship of suffering. It only happens by standing with other believers when they are going through crisis. It means walking together through the tough times. This not only draws people together, but it's also a powerful testimony to the world. Read a couple of scriptures for you, and we're going to pray. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. How will people know? If we love one another. How will people know that we are really Christ's disciple? If when they come to church, they see us loving one another. I want to ask you this. Look around you. Do you love me? Yeah, I'm not talking to the person that you normally talk to. I'm talking to the person that you don't even have a conversation with. Do you really love them? All right, listen, just look around you again. Just look left, right, all around. Do you, when I say me, look at all the me's around you. How many of the me's around you do you really love? Because if I've been here for 1 year and you really love me, you should know my name. Do you know it? The Bible says that our love for each other will prove to the world that we are Christ's disciples. 1 John 4:20. Those who do not love their brothers and sisters whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have never seen. 1 John 3:14 in the New Living Translation says, but if we love our Christian brothers and sisters, it proves that we have passed from death to eternal life. So as we close this morning, which of these levels of fellowship are you at? How about membership? Have you made a choice to belong? If you're still jumping from fellowship to fellowship, you can join us. This is a place where you'll be loved. And maybe that means considering being baptized when we have baptism on the 21st. Maybe you need to commit to friendship. Maybe you need to learn to share. Share your home, share your experiences, share your problems with others. Maybe you need to share some of your stuff, you know? Some of those things that, the good stuff you have, the expensive one that you buy but you're not using. You know, maybe you can share some of that with others. Maybe you already have a good group of friends but you need to move to the next level of partnership. That means doing your part. Find your niche. Find your place to give back. To make a contribution. We need your input. The church needs you. People are coming every Sunday that needs you. They need you to call. They need you to pray. They need you to help them get a seat. They need you to teach them things. Kids need you. Teenagers. The elderly need you. Maybe they need you to be part of the group that visit them and help them when they're in the hospital. Maybe they are other believers that need to know you're devoted to them. Perhaps you need to allow others to enter into your area of need and stand with them in their place of suffering. Lastly, in order to find your place in the family of God, you need to be a part of the family of God. That means you must have a personal relationship with Christ. And if you have never done that before, now is a great day to take that first step, to make a decision to be a part of God's family. That is by giving your life to Him, surrendering your life to Him. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. Quickly, just if you're here this morning, you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, and you want to commit your life to Him, you want to be a part of God's family, oh, how I would enjoy praying for you. And I know every believer in this house this morning will enjoy you making that decision and that commitment. So if that's you, with no pressure, just out of pure love, the love that we have for you and God has for you, you want to commit your life to Him this morning, if you could just raise your hand right where you are so I can acknowledge you. And if I do that, once I acknowledge you, you can put your hands down and I'm going to lead you in a very simple prayer. You want to commit your life to Him, anyone this morning in this room. Mr. Pastor, you know, I know that this is God. I see that hand there. Hallelujah. Anyone else this morning? Hallelujah. And this is a commitment that is challenging you to even water baptism. Like this is it. This is the moment of God's movement. And if you move with God's wave, greater things are yet to be done in your life. See the one person who stand up, which is going to ask you, because I want one of the members to come and stand beside you. I'm just going to ask you to just stand to your feet. Just be bold enough. I'm standing too, so you won't be embarrassed. Just stand with her right there. She's right beside you, right? So just stand with her. So we're going to pray. No distraction. Just be focused. Now, some of you need to make a decision either about membership, partnership, friendship. Come on, you know who you are, our kinship. You need to start either acting more like this is a family, or you need to become more friendly by sharing your experiences and problems, sharing your home. Maybe it's about just membership, just making a choice to belong. Maybe I don't know, but you know where you are. God is speaking to you. I challenge you to make a commitment right there in your heart. So Heavenly Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus, Lord God Almighty. We thank you for your work. We thank you for your word. We thank you for what you're doing in this city. We thank you for what you're doing in this church. We thank you for what you're doing in the lives of your people today. And we pray for the one person this morning who by faith lifted their hands as a recommitment to you, Almighty God. I pray that Spirit of the Living God, you will minister graciously and mercifully unto her, bringing her, Lord God, into that deep, intimate relationship with you. I pray that she will find her place in the kingdom, and she will not just believe, but belong in the name of Jesus. I pray for those in attendance today, Lord God Almighty, that for those of us who have been hopping and moving from here to there, that we will get planted so we can begin to grow. We will bloom where we are planted, Lord God. And I pray that they'll get planted in the kingdom and planted into a church family in the name of Jesus. I pray, Lord God, that they will begin to develop friendship to the point where they begin to share. There'll be a partnership, Lord God Almighty, where they'll begin to do their part in fulfilling God's kingdom here on earth. But there'll be a kinship, Lord God, a love, a deep, deep love that we share with each other, that when visitors come, that they will experience not just the worship, they will experience not just a sermon, but they'll experience the love of God in the atmosphere. We thank you, Lord God Almighty, for what you are doing. We thank you that you have made us for relationship, and you have made us to fit together as a perfect people for your perfect kingdom. We thank you, Lord. We bless you, and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, just clap your hands to the Lord. Hallelujah. Listen, I want you to stand to your feet. And here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I know you want to leave so, so quickly. And I know, but before you do that, right, remember three things, right? Baptism on the 21st. Bible study coming up. And you can sign up for cell group. And the final thing is that, can you greet three persons and just tell them, I love you. And we are in this together. Amen. Three persons. All right. Just any three persons. Just tell them you love them. Let them know that we are in this together as the praise and worship team takes us out with a song of praise. Hallelujah.
Jesus,
for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. All that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me.